Hello, and welcome to this week's edition of the Ride Along Radio Show, the show where you have veteran police officers giving their perspective on issues and topics of the day that affect the community and the people at large.
Veteranos.
Los veteranos. I'm George Holt.
I'm Gil Contreras.
And between the two of us, we have, I think we never really sat down and run the numbers on it, but it's got to be 40-something years, probably more than that now. Yeah. Yeah, more than that, probably 50-something years now.
Look, I've been in a uniform since I was 16.
Yeah, me too.
So
yeah, me too.
I've been having guns. I've been involved with having a gun since I was 16.
So there's no telling. Some capacity, right?
Yeah.
No, you're right, man. So and you figure I started in 89, retired in 2014. That's 25 years. And then you were doing it before I came on, and you weren't even new then.
I was.
So that's more than 50
years. I
started
as a police explorer, for God's sake.
Yeah, well, I started as an explorer in high school, too. I was West Hollywood Sheriff in 1983.
That was 1973.
Oh, my God. Man, did they even have explorers?
They did.
That's back when Code 3 was giddy up.
Look, let me tell you something. That's when police officers were, they were problem solvers. You know, they didn't really think of themselves as, quote, warriors, close quote. We hadn't hit that warrior culture
right.
that we're in now because of the, you know, the
September didn't have the
11th.
Wars. Yeah, we didn't have the wars. And
so it was, you know, 9/11, today's cops are, you know, they're the front line against terrorism.
Terrorism,
now.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
You know, they're more as on the front line here at home as our military is on the front lines out in, you know, on the battlefield out there.
Yeah,
you know,
they're in the many ways in terms of, sure, exactly.
But
in many ways.
Yeah, that's... You know, those were the guys. It was Adam 12 LAPD that I knew and fell in love with.
That was the old school.
Yeah.
Old school. Well, you know, we throw that experience in there and our collective experience, and we try to allow you to view these topics through our filter, all right? When I say filter, the lens through which we view the topics. And so,
right, and it's we, not George and Gil. It's
right,
we
law enforcement collectively
trained law enforcement people, correct?
Right, exactly. I mean, you know, you'll get our personal stuff in there sometime, but we try to just approach it as, hey, this is what happened, and this is how we look at it. Now, you may look at it differently, but this is how we look at it, right?
And
based on our training and experience,
exactly. And this is why we look at it this way,
exactly. So that's how this show goes, okay? And if at any point you want to call in, you got something to say. You can reach us at 323-293-3375. So now we do social media feedback at the top of the show. And I meant to get to this last week because Ride Along Radio Show regular viewer Kyle K-Dog Brewer wants to know, what is the legal authority of bounty hunters? And we're talking bounty hunters, not as in Bounty Hunter Bloods out of Nickerson Gardens, but bounty hunters like Dog the Bounty Hunter. And who's the other famous bounty hunter before him? There was another guy who was like a famous TV bounty hunter. Anyway, Boba Fett, not like that kind of bounty hunter, okay? Like the kind of guys who go out and grab fugitives like Dog does. So what are bounty hunters? Bounty hunters, also known as bail enforcement agents, are people who seek out fugitives for a monetary reward. They have no official authority, but are typically agents of bail bondsmen who will owe the bail money for the fugitives if they evade the court. So you know how that works. You get locked up. Call my mama. Mama puts up the house. And bails $100,000. She's got to put up 10%, so she's got to come with 10 grand cash. The other 90% of that bond is guaranteed by the house or whatever other collateral got put up. And then when you don't show up for court, the bail bondsman is on the hook for that, which is why he's going to take your mama's house and then send somebody after you
to
recover that.
The county in which you post the bond, if you disappear, if the suspect disappears and the bail agent can't find him, the county keep, because the bail agent has to deposit the 30 grand.
Oh, yeah, he's got to put it in there, sure.
So,
or whatever it is, 100 grand or whatever it is, yeah.
But narcotics cases were like 30 grand. Those are the ones we worked a lot. And so, if they can't find the guy, the court just takes your 30 grand.
It's forfeit.
Okay, well, thank you very much. Thank you for that. And then the bail bond agent now goes after the family of the suspect. And
right.
That's when you collect the house and whatever else.
They'd rather not do that. They'd rather just go ahead, get you, turn you in, get their bond back and keep that 10% in their pocket.
Correct.
If you think about it, that's a good business to have a 10% return on your money like that. That's actually not bad. It's not too, especially with a fast turnaround.
Right.
It's 10% on a quick turnaround. Now, 10% annually may not be that high, but 10% on a quick turnaround is pretty good.
Well, I know a guy. Yeah, I know, of course, know a little bunch of guys in this business, but you know, I was just talking to a buddy of mine the other day about this, and you know, it's such a cutthroat business too. So. you know, that 10%, people are going, okay, well, give us half.
Right.
Okay, well.
Sure, like anything else.
You know, so, you know, it was, you know, a few years ago it was good. Now everything's a misdemeanor.
Yeah, that's right, huh? Yeah, it got knocked down, sure.
It's a different state
now. It's a different business.
But, you know, it's criminal friendly now, but it used to be a good business. And, you know, finding these guys, you know, is just working like any other fugitive case. And I actually went to Mexico.
Oh, did you?
I did
that too.
I went to Mexico with a guy who used to operating down there, and there was a guy who was wanted for 187, and we were working in conjunction with LAPD fugitive unit.
Okay.
So they were waiting at the border.
Right.
It was all set up.
Sure.
And we were supposed to go to this guy's house in the Colonia, get him in the car, and he was going to come voluntarily. And you know,
really. So
he was supposed to get in the car, and then we were just going to drive right back over the border, hand him off to LAPD.
Right.
And
done deal.
We made our money. It would have been easy.
Would have been.
Of course, we get to the Colonia. He sees us pull up in an SUV. The moment we got out of the car, the houses are on hills, right? So his little shack is up there. And he sees us get out of the car, sunglasses, these two-looking guys.
Yeah, right.
And he just panicked when he saw us, and he took off running through the hills and – the family ran after him. We didn't, but the family ran after him. And, you know, I didn't realize how dangerous this was, but here we are walking. Walking around on foot in Tecate.
Yeah, right by the border.
In the Colonias, you know, I mean, dirt roads.
Tecate, where they make the beer, yeah.
Yeah.
I've been there.
They make more than beer down there.
Yeah.
But I'll tell you something, I wouldn't go down there now. But that was, you know.
That was pre-cartel, right?
Yeah.
Well, so the question is, what's the legal authority of bounty hunters? Well, because they are not police officers, bounty hunters are not required to follow the same strict rules as policemen, such as needing a warrant to enter someone's private property. When people agree to their bail bond contract, they sign an agreement allowing bounty hunters to come after them should they break the agreement. The bounty hunter can enter the home of the suspect unannounced and transport him across state lines.
Yep.
Now, are there any limits to bounty hunting? There are some limits to what a bounty hunter can do. Bounty hunters can enter the home of the suspect in order to make an arrest. However, in order to enter the home of the suspect's friends or family, they usually need a reasonable suspicion that the fugitive is present. And this may depend on the laws of the state, et cetera, et cetera.
And that's why you have to, it's a regular investigation. You solve these cases like you do any other shoe work.
In terms of where the guy is.
Knocking on doors, handing out business cards.
Sure. Now, what about a reward? You guys sometimes give people a reward. Hey, I give you $100. You tell me where the dude is, or there's like a system we've in place for that.
Well, we don't call it a reward, but
it's an incentive.
Hey, there's an incentive. You know,
there's an incentive.
If your tip leads to his capture, sure. You know,
nice.
We got a little something for you.
Right. It's an incentive. You got to incentivize the people. You got to motivate them to do the right thing.
Let me tell you something. You find a girlfriend who's mad.
Right, because he's laying up with the other girlfriend.
I tell you where he is. I know where.
and when you get him, tell him I said.
And some of them are really, you know, they're really involved cases. And, you know, one involved domestic violence that I worked on. And, you know, I went to the wife at work. I showed up. At her job.
Uh-huh.
I suited up. And, you know, she let me in, took me into the conference room. And, you know, she just broke down in tears about what she was going through.
Wow.
And I go, well, you know.
We can solve all this.
Are you going to tell me or not? I mean, this is up to you.
Right.
And she looked at me with tears in her eyes. She goes, he's at a house across the street from his brother where they were living.
Yeah.
Two doors down.
Wow.
We were at the house the night previous, and he's across the street.
Probably watching you guys.
Two doors down. But so we went back the next day at 0600, and, you know, the word that we had gotten was, oh, yeah, you know, the dude's going to fight and whatever. So
sure.
Three of us went, and one of the guys had a beanbag thing. And I'll never forget it. We knock on the door, and the girlfriend comes. You know, it's real early, like 6.
Uh-huh.
She comes to the door, and she goes, "Hey." I go, "Hey."
Wait, now he was staying with the girlfriend.
Yeah.
In the same neighborhood where the wife was staying at his brother's house.
Across the street, two doors down.
Uh-huh.
So I tell the girlfriend, "I'm here for." I say his name. "I'm here for so and so. Where's he at?" She just looked at me. Says, "He back there."
Oh, wow. She's sick of his shit.
So she pointed to that door, to a door. It was closed. Says, "He in there alone?" She said, "Yeah." He got any weapons? "I don't know. Sit down right here. Don't move."
Right.
We walk in, and, you know, I try the door. It's unlocked. I push it open. There he's asleep. Bigger than.
Oh, nice.
He's asleep on the bed.
Like a baby.
And I'll never forget. So we kind of, you know, surround the bed, and I'm in the center. And I tap his feet with my flashlight. tap his foot.
Oh, my God. Talk about a rude awakening.
And I go, Francisco. And he's going,
what?
And then I said, Francisco, open your eyes. And just as I did that, I had a scanner on my vest, right? Uh-huh. So the scanner said something, because we were in like Redlands or something. So yeah. The scanner goes off. It says something. When he heard the police radio, his eyes got big.
Right.
And then he went like this. And he sat up. Now there's three of us, and one guy's pointing a beanbag to him.
Right.
So, Francisco, you're under arrest. Turn over on your stomach. Put your hands behind your back. Don't move.
Yeah.
He sat there for a minute.
He's trying to figure out if this is real or not.
Exactly. So he went like
this. He did it again.
I said, Francisco, turn on your stomach, put your hands behind your back, and don't move.
Right.
So he just flipped over real quick, put his hands. He didn't know what
happened.
He couldn't process it fast enough.
Right, right. And, good. He didn't have time to formulate a plan.
It was funny, you know, when we used to work fugitives, you know, sometimes you get a file, whatever, and you go, I don't feel this. That's what I used to do. I put my hand up. I'm not feeling him. Listen, I'm feeling this dude. Let's work this one. And there's something about that, because when you put focused energy on something, there's some connection that you can't see that's in the universe. And Francisco, when we were taking him to the San Bernardino County Jail, he's in the back seat and he's going, man. He goes, you know what, man? I was dreaming that you motherfuckers were coming for me. I've been dreaming about it. That's why he didn't know
if it was real or not. He's thinking, again?
But he.
No, you know what? I totally agree with you. I totally agree that there's something that we don't understand yet. Yeah. That there's
in a connection between human beings. Yeah. He knew somebody was coming for him, and he knew we were getting closer.
Yeah. Yeah, well, you know, that's that sixth sense. He should have listened to it. He should have slept someplace else that night.
Yeah.
But, you know, he had to go. So, Kyle, K-Dog Brewer, thanks for the question, and there's your answer. And, you know, Gil's got some practical experience with that. I thought about dabbling in it at one point, but I didn't do it. But it looks like you actually got into it, so.
Yeah, me and Stuart and some other guys, we did that for a while. And, you know, it's nice because, you know, once you find the guy, you know, you go back to the bondsman, you go to court, you get your bond exonerated. Once you get that little slip, you bring it back to the bond guy.
You get paid.
You get a check for $4,000, $3,000, $10,000, whatever the
whatever it was.
Is. Yeah,
whatever nice. It was. That's beautiful. Yep. All right. Well, so we posted a video on the Ride Along Radio Show Facebook page last week. And it was a video about a – we didn't show it on the show because it's kind of a long video, but we have a distilled version of it here. It's a member of the paparazzi at LAX. His name is Tony Vera. And Tony Vera has been at LAX for quite some time, probably about 15 years now. And he's a guy who does a lot of photography. That's what he does. He's a paparazzi guy.
Right.
He's there all the time. And so this is a video of him attempting to video Nick Cannon. In fact, he had interacted with Nick Cannon earlier, the comedian actor Nick Cannon, and had videoed him going up through screening. And then he gets approached by a Los Angeles Airport police officer who has some questions for Mr. Vera. And we'll play the video, and then we'll come back and talk about it. Tell us what you think, sir.
This is called a form of harassment. I've been working here for 14 years. I do LAPD videos. This guy's going to stop me when I'm doing my job in a public airport.
North or south escalator to green.
It'll be the south escalator.
I mean, I love cops and everything, but a lot of cops I don't like, man. And this is one of them.
So I understand that this is a public area.
You don't understand anything, dude, because if you did, you wouldn't be harassing me right now.
Dude.
No, you don't. No, you don't. No, you don't. No, you don't, dude.
Believe it, man.
You need to ask who Tony Vera is, man.
Okay.
Simple.
Not a problem.
Simple, man. I'm here 9 hours a day, 7 days a week.
So
I know your boss.
How's it going?
My problem is, I'm doing my job. I'm taping that cannon. He gets in my face. No, man. You guys want to arrest me or arrest
no,
me
no,
then?
No.
Seriously, man.
I just want to talk to you.
What's that?
I know you, man. Come on. What's going on?
He's got a problem.
All right. What happened?
What happened? I'm taping Nick Cannon, and this guy gets in my face. That's what happened.
Who are you taping?
Nick Cannon. But it doesn't make a difference. This is a public area. I got a press pass. And I've been here for 14 damn years.
And I asked you.
I don't have to show you my. I don't have to show you my ID. I have not committed a crime, officer. And you're gonna be big time on YouTube in that, by the way. Big time. I have not committed a crime, so I don't have to show you my ID.
All right. So that's the question of how was that handled? And I'm going to start off with a disclaimer that I know everybody in that video, except the passengers walking around in the background. You know, anybody who spent any time there is either seen or interacted with Mr. Vera. And at a certain point, if you watch the whole video, he drops a name that's familiar to us on the Ride Along radio show. He says, I know Marshall. I know Marshall. And he's referring to Marshall McClain, who's often been a guest here. On the Ride Along radio show, who's the president of the Los Angeles Airport Police Officers Association. So so it's very interesting. And and so our, basically we asked, hey, what are your thoughts? And Vivian Ferguson posts on Facebook. She goes, I'm guessing because they didn't arrest him, he was right. He didn't have to show his ID if there was no probable cause. Also guessing if he's been doing that job in the airport for 14 years, that's not the first time that happened, and he would know his rights by now. Well, and you like to think so. Mm-hmm. You like to think so. But let me start off by saying this. There are three different areas in any airport, especially a large airport like LAX. We call that a Category X airport. It's the highest level of security in an airport. There is the sterile area where you board the planes and buy the $7 sodas and all that stuff after you've been through screening. There is the secure area where they screen your bags and handle your bags and throw them around and bust the locks off of them and all that kind of stuff down below. The secure area also consists of the airfield. So when you see people driving out on the airfield and around the planes and everything, that's the secure area. Well, then there's the other part that happens when you first just get out of your car and walk in and you're getting your ticket and showing your ID and all that. That's called the public area. And it's called the public area because it's a public area, and there are some laws that are in place at certain airports that, like, you can't bring a gun into even the public area of certain mm-hmm. airports. But that is basically county to county, depending on what they allow their concealed weapon permit holders to do. So Mr. Vera, and I'm not big on paparazzi, haven't worked at, in that environment for a number of years. I found them to be a headache more than anything else. But you are not obligated to present your identification if you're not being detained. And I think that's where the question comes in. Now, you guys would have to watch the whole video to get the big picture. But there's a whole other part where a supervisor shows up. Supervisor talks to him. At the end of it, they walk away. They don't handcuff him. They don't run him for warrants or anything like that, as I mm-hmm. recall, right? But I will say that, you know, That's a situation where an officer comes up and makes a consensual encounter with you, and just kind of makes casual contact to converse with you. That's one thing. But when you start asking for people's ID and you're telling them you're not free to leave, then you have a detention, and it's a whole other level. So, you brought this whole thing up. So what's your take
right,
on
no,
it?
I wanted to know what you guys, you know, what you and Marshall thought because. You know, I get accused of being a police apologist. You know, like there's not a thing a cop can do that I don't like. You
right,
know,
which always, is not the case. You've criticized right. police actions here.
But when I saw this, you know, I just think, you know, that young cop, number one, with all the tattoos and stuff, I was just thinking, what are you doing? Why? If you know who he is, you know, if you want to say, hey, man, who are you taping? Who are you talking to?
Well, that's what the other officer did.
Who, yeah, exactly.
And that other, but let me, to be fair, the second officer who showed up who says, I know you, he's been there a long time, and he wasn't always an airport police officer. He worked at the airport in another capacity. He was a traffic officer working the curb for many years where you interact with the paparazzi, uh-huh. and then he was selected to become a police officer and went to the academy, and now he's a sworn officer. Anyway, so he's got a little better background with the situation. That's why he's got a little better rapport
But the first guy, you know, he's a full uniform cop.
Oh, no, they're both full uniform. They're all full uniform.
I understand that. So the other guy may, you know, he may have more experience or something.
He's got more experience, yeah.
However, the young guy should at least know his job. You know, and I didn't understand why was he trying to get his ID? And then why is he continuing? And then why is he calling for, I would have been embarrassed. And if I when I was an FTO, if my boot had done something like that, I would have let Mr. Vera go. I would apologize to him. Sorry about the detention. Sorry about this. I see you all the time. Have a good one.
Right.
I'm gonna be looking for your YouTube video. And then when we get out of sight, I would take my little boot back to the station and have a come to Jesus meeting about interacting with the public.
Well,
there was no reason for that. The guy wasn't interfering with anything. There was no cause.
Well, that's the thing is there was okay. So now looking back on it, as it's already over, we can talk about it, and we kind of have a feel for what went on. There was clearly no call for service. There was
correct.
No one who said
no radio call.
That the guy was right. No radio call, et cetera, or even apparently a flag down. A citizen goes, "Hey, that guy over there is doing something wrong."
Right.
It appeared to be an officer initiated activity, which means the officer saw it and goes, "I'm gonna see what's up with that," and makes contact with the subject. In this case, Mr. Vera. Again, the dude's there all the time. But when you are filming a sensitive area like an airport, now in that officer's defense, maybe he hasn't dealt with him before. The officer hasn't been well. This video was shot, I think, a year ago, so the officer is not new at all. But he's not like the other guy who's been there for much longer. So maybe he didn't really know who the guy was.
Has he been there more than 6 months?
Certainly.
Okay, but he knows his job then. As he should.
Certainly.
He should know.
No, I'm saying we need to remove the factor of I know who Tony Vera is because maybe he didn't know who Tony Vera is.
It doesn't even matter who.
But, right, let's talk about that. Right, so let's talk about that then. So it doesn't really matter.
Correct.
If you don't know who he is. But if you don't know who he is, then you're wondering why has he got this camera in here? And what is he doing exactly? Now, here's the thing. You ask him those questions.
That's right.
And if he says, oh, I'm filming something for a movie I'm doing, well, you need a film permit for that, blah, 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 blah. But if he says, I'm filming Nick Cannon, you know this is a paparazzi-heavy environment. Mm-hmm. And so then maybe at that point you say, all right, have a good day.
Say, did you see him? Okay, cool. All right. Have a good one, brother.
Have a good day.
Be safe.
Right. Yeah. And you know, I haven't talked to anybody involved in this.
I mean, it's not a big deal. There's not going to be a complaint.
No, there's nothing like. The police got a question.
What if Nick Cannon was complaining about
Barra? Not really, because you're in a public airport. Now what did happen, what we didn't see, was that Tony Vera followed Nick Cannon in. When he got out of his vehicle at the sidewalk, at the curb, he interacted with him, he talked with him, and they talked all the way through.
Right.
Now, if Nick Cannon didn't want to be bothered and said, this guy is harassing me, that's another story.
Correct.
That's another story, yeah.
But Nick Cannon, you know, he was just engaged with the guy.
He was engaging with the guy, just this banter, like it was no problem. And the guy said, hey, sorry about the loss of your grandfather.
Yeah,
and then Nick
that.
Cannon starts talking to him about that.
They love that.
Right. So clearly, in fact, I think he was going to the funeral is what he was doing, and that was a conversation they were having. It was no problem there.
The reason I sent.
I think he's a stringer, and so he'll sell to whoever.
Yeah.
He's one of those guys.
But the reason I even sent it to you is because I thought, well, that first officer, okay, you know, that's kind of silly, you know, his little interaction there. But then when the sergeant came, and I watched the sergeant, and I, you know, he was, you know, I mean, there's good sergeants that ask good questions and come, you know, they come to good conclusions and they look professional. And then I just thought, for a sergeant, boy, this guy's asking some really dumb questions. And the way it all ended, and when they walked away from each other, I just thought, man, what a bunch of rookies! They just looked like a bunch of rookies to me.
Knowing that sergeant professionally and personally, socially, in fact, the last time I saw him was at a mutual friend's house at a barbecue out in the Palm Desert last summer. That sergeant is very, very experienced. He's probably got more experience than any other sergeant on that agency, especially now that I'm gone. But he retired from another agency where he had some rank, and he was a detective supervisor, et cetera. Mm-hmm. And so he comes there, and he brings the benefit of that. But maybe
but
he just wasn't as engaged as he typically would have been. I'm just saying, it's not from lack of experience. He's very experienced, sharp
for
guy.
For such a smart guy, he was asking really dumb questions. And I submit to you that the reason he was asking dumb questions is he knew he had nothing. There was no reason. What he should have said was, hey, you know what, Tony? Thanks. Sorry about the miscommunication here. Be on your way. That's what he should have said. And just let it go. And then he should have went back to the other officer and said, what is this all about? Why are we making a scene? Why do we have three officers and a sergeant for a paparazzi guy who's done nothing. What, tell me why. Tell me why we're doing that. Okay, yeah, thank you very much.
Well, and I'll say this about the culture of that agency is that everything you do, you've got a bunch of people there with you, which is a luxury. Sometimes it's a crutch.
Right.
So, yeah, that incident. So, hey, so listen, now that you guys have seen that, if you want to go and see the whole thing, you can go to our Ride Along Radio Show page, the Facebook page, and click on the link there. It'll take you to the whole video. It's like 14 minutes long. And then circle back around and tell us what you think. You can either leave the comments on YouTube, or you can leave the comments like Vivian Ferguson did right there on the Facebook page. Because we'd like to know what you guys' thoughts were about that.
Boom.
Yeah. So I'm going to do this, and I think we can get into the break, and then we can come back and get into our first news story. So last week, we talked about Don Lemon, the real Don. Not John Lemon, the real Don Lemon we talked about. And I made a comment about him being a journalist. And Gil said, John Lemon's not a journalist. He's a commentator.
Ah.
Remember that?
I do.
And I said, okay, so like a talking head. Okay. So I thought about that. I go, well, I don't really know the dude's background. I'm just curious, so let me look. So here's a quasi-rebuttal, according to Wikipedia. In his earliest career... I verified this on CNN site, too.
I was going to say, who wrote it?
Don Lemon? Don Lemon might have wrote it. No, he didn't write this, but I'm getting ready to read. You wait till I get to the end. So I verified it against CNN's official bio, et cetera, et cetera. So, all right. In his earliest career, Lemon reported as a weekend anchor for WBRC in Birmingham, Alabama, and WCAU in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, anchor and investigative reporter for KTVI St. Louis, an anchor for WBRC in Birmingham, Alabama. Lemon reported for NBC News New York City operations, including working as a correspondent for Today and NBC Nightly News and an anchor on Weekend Today and MSNBC. In 2003, he began at NBC O&O station WMAQ, which is 5 in Chicago, Channel 5, and was a reporter as well as a local news anchor. So I'm like, okay, well, he's been an investigative reporter and a correspondent, so that makes him a journalist, okay? And then I read the entry that said, however, in 2014, Lemon was named to a list of worst journalists in a Columbia Journalism Review ranking. So John Lemon, you guys got me screwed up, man. Don Lemon is a journalist, but he's not a very good one, apparently, according to Columbia Journalism Review.
Don Lemon was a journalist. He's now a commentator.
Right, he's a commentator. But he's got a background in journalism. So. Correct. Anyway, I just thought that was interesting that there was this whole piece. I'm like, oh, man. Well, yeah, all right. Oh, wow. Well, all right. All right, cool.
Is this, am I doing my news of the day story right now?
We're going to run to the break, and then we come back. We can just dive right into the news of the day because we are at that time. All right, folks, we're going to be right back in a minute, and we'll see you when we get back. All right, and that was Gang of Four. I Love a Man in a Uniform. I always like that song. Yeah. Right. Is that maybe that's why we got into the field, because we get to wear uniforms and women love that. Anyway,
yeah, they do.
That's what I hear.
So they say.
So they allegedly. Allegedly.
Whoever they are.
Yeah, they talk a lot. So okay, so you had a news story.
Yeah. You know, I have my news of the day or news of the week is, you know, last week it's been sad for us, for me and Patricia. Our little pack has gotten smaller. My golden retriever, she was 11.
You were just talking about her on last week's show, actually. Yeah. Talking about when you were taking her to be a detection, learning how to be a detection dog.
Right.
Yeah, you were just talking about her. Yeah.
So. You know, she had been sick. She'd been sick for a little bit, but we didn't think it was critical, but, you know, she wasn't feeling well. She'd been at the vet for the last 2 months, uh-huh. You know, like once a week. And so last Friday, you know, I come home and we have, you know, when you live with dogs, they think in a pack mentality. And when you're the humans living with them, you all become a pack. And so the way that you create a happy and healthy life for a dog is routine. Everything's routine for them.
Okay.
So you know, things happen around the same time. They go to the bathroom at the same time.
Sure.
They eat at the same time. It all happens at the same time. So I come home on Friday, and you know, she had been to the vet, and I'd been waiting to hear back from him. They were going to talk to an internal specialist, and we were wondering, you know, well, what's the next step for her?
Right.
And so I get home my regular time around 3, and, you know, they're both there, she and Randa, and they're happy to see me. Tails are wagging. Sure. And, you know, so I put all my stuff down and get their leashes, and they get real happy, and they go out to get to go out and, you know, go tinkle and stuff. And so I come back. And then usually, you know, I change my clothes, I cook my lunch, you know, I have my dinner around 3:30, 4 o'clock, they eat, and then 5 o'clock, Patricia comes home, and then we all go out.
Okay.
That's the routine. That was the daily routine for the last number of years.
Wow. Okay.
And so, you know, while I'm eating, Evie's not doing well. I had seen where she had thrown up during the day at some point, and, you know, so while I'm eating, she threw up a couple more times, so I finish up, and I clean it up, and... you know, she comes, she lays down near me and by the bar stools there, and she doesn't look good to me, right? You know, and, you know, being trained for medical emergencies for humans, you know, you're used to looking at someone and making a quick assessment.
Right.
And going, okay, do I need to do something to stabilize you? Do I need to transport you? Do I need to call? What do I need to do? So she looked, and so I called, actually called the vet, and I said, hey, and I got, you know, I got one of the docs on the line, and I said, hey, Evie just doesn't look good to me. And I was just wondering if, you know, Dr. I'll say his name later, but if he had had a chance to talk to the internal specialist, because, you know, we're going into the weekend and we just kind of want to know. She didn't eat this morning. She didn't go to the bathroom yesterday.
And now she's throwing up.
Yeah. Kind of concerned she's throwing up here. She goes, well, I don't know if he did or didn't, but I don't see it in the notes. Let me call you back in 5 minutes. Okay. So I turn, I look at Evie. And she doesn't look, she looks even worse to me, right?
Wow, that fast.
And I even walked over to the computer desk and I pulled up dog CPR.
Oh, wow.
I just wanted to, you know, like look at it real quick.
Yeah.
In case I had to do it, because I was thinking, she doesn't look good.
Wow, what was her breathing like?
She was breathing okay, uh-huh. But she wasn't moving. She wasn't getting up. So I go, I look at the computer, I look at the first few minutes of the video, okay, I got it. Come back to the, you know, my phone rings, where I'm talking to the vet, and where she's going, you know, he couldn't get a hold of him, but if you think she's not, you know, I said, well, I don't think she's in distress, but she just doesn't look good, and I'm looking at her, so I said, hold on a second, I said, Evie girl. And usually if I call her, she at least look at me.
Yeah.
She didn't move her head. She didn't.
Oh, wow.
She didn't respond. And she goes, yeah, you know, you better just go ahead and take her to the hospital.
Right.
I'll call ahead and we'll email over her records and stuff. And okay. They'll be waiting for you. So I say, okay. So I get on the phone. Now I got to call Patricia, right?
Right. Tell her what's going on. Sure.
Hey, look, I'm going to have to take Evie. She just doesn't look good. And, you know, well, are you sure? Yeah.
Now, what do you do with Randa with all this going on?
Well, so now here comes, you know, my little circus, right? So, okay, I got to get Evie to my car. I don't think she can get up. So I have to get her to the car, because we live in a condo complex, right? So I got to get her down to the garage.
Right.
And but I can't do one thing with her, because now I'm standing up and walking around. Now, Randa's right at my feet. Sure. Like, are we going to go do something? We're going to go do something?
Right,
Randa. So I go, okay, let me go get Randa into the car, because the car's set up for her. So I get Randa, go down, put her in the car, because she rides in the back seat behind the little fence thing.
Right.
And but the back of the truck is just filled with gear, equipment, dog food.
Sure, sure.
Nice. So I go, oh, shit, I got to take all my stuff out, set it in, you know, set it down. I go get the – I'd seen a hand cart, and I thought, if I ever have to carry Evie down, I'm going to turn that into a gurney, and sure enough.
You're able to do it.
I go get it. I go up. You know, I get her thing, make her a gurney out of one of her cushions, one of her – and so now I'm trying to wheel – and I'm like, oh, shit. It doesn't fit. I got it. Oh. And I'm like, oh, I got to move the bar stools. So, I mean, you know, as you're doing these things, you know, I'm kind of antsy now.
Right.
And now things are starting to not go right. Yeah, I can't get the thing in.
Sure.
So I'm moving stuff, and finally I get it in there, and I, you know, I get on my knees. I'm trying to put, she's like 77 pounds, right?
Oh, wow.
So I scoop her up in my arms like this, and I'm on my knees, right? So I scoop her up and I pick her up.
Now you got to stand up.
And well, no, I just had to walk on my knees just a couple of inches and then put her onto the gurney. But when I scooped her up and had her like this, her head just went, you know, she couldn't even hold her head up. So I get her on the gurney and, you know, I'm checking.
But she's still conscious and breathing.
She's still conscious. She's still breathing. Okay. I still have a heartbeat. You know, so I'm talking, now I'm talking to her, right? Okay, right. Okay, Eva girl, you know, just I'm going to get you to the dock. We're going to see what we can do. And so I'm trying to pull her, get her to the car. And now it's Friday afternoon traffic. And I'm trying to get from Playa to Culver City.
Yeah, sure.
And on surface streets.
Right.
And it's just, you know, and the whole way there, I'm talking to her. I'm sure. Singing to her. You know, Randa's in the back seat, just quiet. She's, you know, normally
she knows what's up, though. She knows something's not right.
So, you know, I just thought, well, I can't be back there with her, but if she hears my voice, I remember reading once that the dogs don't understand what you say, but when you talk to them, it makes them feel better. They feel more okay. comforted. So, I'm driving and I'm talking to her, and I'm saying, "Okay, Evie, a little bit more, sweetie. Hang on. We'll, you know, see what the doc says." And you know.
Yeah.
I didn't really know what was going to happen. Finally, I get there. It takes me about 35 minutes to make a 15-minute drive.
Wow, yeah. It's that rush hour traffic.
Yeah. And, you know, I pop the back of the truck, and I go, okay. Pop the back of the truck, and, you know, she's not moving. I call her name. No heartbeat.
No heartbeat?
Check for a pulse. And she's gone.
She passed on the way there.
On the way there, she passed. And, you know, so they came
But
out.
You know what? At least she wasn't in some cold room surrounded by strangers.
Yeah.
Randa and was in the car. You were there in the car.
Herself,
you were talking to her.
And so I just wanted to say, you know, number one, the importance of CPR, pet CPR. And I know you guys at your training center, you actually offer these classes.
Yep. Pet first aid.
And especially
pet dog first aid.
And if you have a working dog, like we have Randa and we have another dog, you know, that's in training, you know, when things go wrong, everything goes wrong.
Right.
Every little thing goes wrong.
Right.
And so, you know, the only thing that mitigates panic is training.
Right.
You know?
Sure.
And
sure.
So, you know, I the training that you guys are offering out there, you know, I think if, you know, I'm going to try to get Patricia and I to get out there at some point to do the training because we still have Randa.
Sure.
We're still going to
interact. And that's actually where it's geared toward a working dog.
Yeah.
Really, because of the kind of injuries they can get.
Right.
Yeah.
And, you know, so just, the, you know, and running, you know, in police work, they used to call it mental gymnastics.
Yeah, that's right.
You know, what would you do if, you know, you come to a stop? What would you do if you start taking gunfire from your right-hand side? What do you do?
Because the time to think about it isn't when it happened. That should
Correct.
Be the first time you ever consider it.
That's right. So, you know, I had thought when she started to get sick, I had thought in my head, you know, at some point, if she deteriorates, you know, her health deteriorates even more, at some point I'm going to have to figure out a way to get her to the car that's effective. I'm going to have to be able to make her a bed back there. I'm going to have to be able to, if I have Randa and I'm by myself, which I was that day.
Yep.
You know, it's going to be the worst circumstance. It's not going to be the best when everybody's home. There's no traffic.
Right.
It's not going to be then. It's going to be at the worst possible moment, at the worst possible time. That's when things happen. And so, you know, having thought about it and stuff, I knew where everything was. I knew what to do.
Right.
And watching her, you know, I knew how to make an assessment. When I realized she was getting critical, made the decision to transport.
To act, yeah.
You know, and I don't know if, you know, 10 minutes, I don't know if 10 minutes would have.
Very nice graphic.
I don't know if it would have made a difference or not, but I want to just share this video that that I made. Can we go back to the beginning? I just want to share a quick video that I made of my Evie girl.
Nice, man.
So that's really
a part of your family, you can tell.
And so I just want to say thank you. A lot of people reached out to me, and you know, we've received flowers and phone calls, and I set up a little memorial page that has photos of her life.
Right.
You know, Evie was So before I had Randa or Patricia, I had Evie.
Right, right.
And
right.
So, you know, Evie and I used to jog together. We'd go hiking together. You know, Evie had a litter, and she had a one of her dogs was named Sam. We kept Sam. He's my daughter's dog now. But
oh, nice.
But at the old house, before we met Patricia, I would sit in my backyard to smoke a cigar, and I would sit on the stairs. And Sam would come under one arm, and Evie would come under the other. And that's how I smoked my cigar with
nice.
Patricia, you know. So, but I wanted to say thank you to everybody who sent a message or a phone call or a text or, you know, left a message on Facebook. But two people in particular, one, John Jordan, who's, you know, an agitator for canines, a trainer, you know, he called and left me a message. And also Ed in Colorado. Ed in Colorado left a comment on a Facebook page.
Now, Ed was a canine handler at one
he
point.
He was. Mm-hmm. He was.
I remember
and
that.
He left. And, you know, they call the passing of a dog, they call it crossing the rainbow bridge.
Oh, really?
And so Ed put this whole thing, this whole story of the rainbow bridge, and it brought tears to my eyes. And
wow.
So
Ed is finding his gentler self in his old age, huh?
So I just wanted to say
wow.
Thank you to Ed in Colorado.
Nice. Very nice.
Thanks to John. And, yeah.
All right, cool, man. Yeah, I know, man. I remember when you told me. I texted you about something else, and you're like, "Hey, this just happened." I'm like, oh my God, man.
Yeah. I was at the hospital.
Right, exactly. Yeah, man. Wow. Well, hey, rest in peace, Evie. You know, she's
Evie
a good dog.
Right.
Yeah, clearly a good dog and a big part of your family, man.
Yeah, she had a good life. She had a good life, but you know how you say when people pass, oh, it was way too short. It really was. Yeah. It was way too short. And, you know, we actually took her to, we did a presentation, demonstration with Randa at the Los Angeles Leadership Academy, a charter school in LA. And I had, so I had Randa and she did her thing, you know, and the kids all clapped when she went running
yeah.
and found dope and whatever. And then we brought Evie too. And, Amat came with me and
oh,
he
okay.
was handling Evie for me. And, you know, so when the whole demonstration with Randa was over, put Randa in the car, and then Evie came out of the car, and they're like, oh.
Another one, yeah.
And
yeah.
so we brought, but she, you know, we took her in, and here's 300 kids, right?
Yeah.
And they're all just, oh, petting, and her tail's just wagging.
She's loving
she
it.
She just loved it.
Nice.
So
like you said, she had a nice life.
She loved
nice.
People, and they loved her back, so.
Very nice.
That's my Evie girl.
Very cool. So you texted me another video. Of something we've been following for, I guess, like 3 weeks in a row now. And it just keeps on getting better.
Yeah, buddy. This was a good video. This
it
one,
really is.
Yeah. It's very clear.
Yeah, it actually is. Well, we may have a caller before we – let's see if we're going to wrestle with somebody here on the air before
Uh-oh.
We get into the video. Is that for us? All right. Caller, what's your name? Where are you calling from?
Good evening, gentlemen.
Wow, isn't this early for you?
Wow.
I didn't expect to hear from you for like another half hour. Oh, it's daylight savings time, huh? We sprung forward or something since then.
Yo, George, I just want to say my condolences to your dog, Gil.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
You know, I had a black Labrador, and she was about 4, 5, 6 months or something like that, and I was driving somewhere, and I tied her leash to the seatbelt in the back seat, and I cracked the window, and as I'm driving down the street, you know, I'm just minding my business, listening to Jeezy, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And some dude on the street is like pointing at my car like, hey, man, look.
Oh.
And I'm like, what the fuck is wrong with him, man? He on that new drug and shit, right? So I look
I'm
in
like,
the
where
back.
This is going.
Yeah.
I look in the back and my dog is gone.
What?
So I pulled over, man. The damn dog done, you know, slipped through the damn crack of the window, man.
Ooh.
She was dangling and shit while I'm driving, doing 40 and shit.
Oh, no.
But, so she was just bouncing, and her leg was all snapped and broken. So I took her to the vet. You know what I mean? Let the vet, you know, look at her. They came out the back, and they was like, hey, man, you know, she severed a nerve, right?
Uh-uh.
But we got to cut amputate her leg.
No.
I was like, all right, man, you know, I love her, man. You know what I'm saying? Do what you got to do. You know what I'm saying? It's my baby. You know what I mean? And it was like, all right, it's going to cost about $1,200. I said, oh, hell no, man. You goddamn kill that bitch.
Oh, my God. See, he reeled us in.
Oh.
He reeled us in.
You wrong for that,
man.
You wrong for
that. Hey, look, Gil, George, they said if you ain't got the money, you know, we can't do the surgery. We'll have to euthanize her. I said, well, kill the bitch, this shit. I ain't paying
There's your baby, though, man. That's grimy. Willie Sweet Wonka Joe. We might have to just drop the sweet and just call you Willie Wonka Joe.
That's right.
Wow, hey, man.
Hey, wasn't nothing sweet about that.
No.
Yo, George. Hey, man. I figured you guys out, though, man. I figured you out, man.
Did you peep our whole car? Man? Go ahead.
Look, you remember Beverly Hills Cop?
Yeah.
You remember when the chief took the first two white boys off of following Axel Foley around?
Right.
And put the other dudes on?
Right. Banana and tailpipe. Right.
Yo, George, give it to me, man. Just say it one time.
Ah, you funny. That's pretty
good.
We're
not going to fall for the banana tailpipe.
Oh, believe me, I got that a couple of times throughout my career. Believe me. That's funny.
I want to be like, nah, George, you got to say it more bass. We're not going to fall for the banana tailpipe, man.
Right. That's right. He said, yeah, put some bass in your voice. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. You're funny, man.
Hey, man, one more thing. I'm gonna wrap it up, man. That cop, man, that looked like a younger version of you back in the day, George, like 1983 version of George Holt right there, man.
Well, that's what I'm telling you. I used to catch that a lot. I'm telling you, I used to get that a lot. I used to get that a lot. Man. That's funny, man. I didn't have that kind of haircut. I never had that flat top haircut.
Hey, man, but listen, man, Gil, man, I'm going to buy this book, right? And, you know, I want to buy it for you, man, but I don't know if I don't want to do that because you ain't going to read the shit. You'll probably, you know what I mean, throw that shit underneath the couch or something. But it's a book. It's written by a man named Edward Bernays. Edward Bernays.
Like
right?
The sauce?
I don't know about like the sauce.
Yeah, go ahead. Go ahead.
The hell you talking about? You been in Kansas City or something? Anyway. Yeah, anyway, it's a book he wrote back in 1928, right?
Mm-mm.
And it's about propaganda and marketing. Right? It's about I'm familiar
with him.
You know what I mean? You following me, Gil?
Oh, yeah.
You see, you know, man, this man, what they say, I forgot what they said, shit. Anyway, something about, you know, evilness can be brilliant. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
This man was a genius, but he was evil. You know what I'm saying? How he came up with these theories of how to manipulate people into buying shit and how to control people's minds, man. Back in 1928, Gil.
Right.
And they still, that shit still applies to this day.
Oh, yeah. That was before TV and definitely before the internet.
Before Mad Men.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, before Mad Men, right? Yeah.
Yeah, man. So, Gil, you already know about it, so I ain't even got to talk to you about it. You know what I'm saying?
Well, I should look him up. Edward Bernays. Like the sauce. All right, man.
I'm going to continue my pursuit to try to, you know what I'm saying, free Gil from the neoconservative prison. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to holler at y'all, man.
All right. Thanks, man. That was Willie Sweet and Wonka Joe, right along, radio show legend. I thought that was going to be a good, compassionate story.
Oh,
about,
I know.
Man, that was funny, though. Wrong, but funny. Okay, so back to the gift that keeps on giving. A couple of weeks ago, we talked about the situation where we had a couple of open carry activists that walked into the Dearborn, Michigan police station. And they came in there with rifles and ski masks and body armor and pistols. Etc., etc., and they were accosted at the front counter. And then we follow that up with them going to court and being arraigned on felony charges for walking into the police station with rifles and ski masks and body armor and pistols, etc., etc. Well, as it turns out, there's another perspective because there was a third person with them. And it makes sense because this whole time we were watching them on the video going to the police station.
Right.
Right? We saw the two guys go in there and they brought their own cameraman. Well, the cameraman apparently had some interaction with the police too. And now we've seen his video released where he shows his perspective of what was going on. But I have to tell you that he was very antagonistic.
Yep.
But I guess you can be real brave when you're not the one with the guns pointed at you because he didn't have a gun. So he knew he wasn't in imminent danger of being shot like his two buddies were. So you can be a little more mouthy when you know the police don't maybe have a little built-in justification to smoke you. So watch this video and see how he conducts himself, and then my favorite part is when they deal with him finally.
Thank you. Dude, put that on the ground. Put it on the ground. Put it on the ground. I'm going to put it on the ground now. Put it on the ground or you are dead.
Listen.
I will shoot you. I will put a round at you, sir.
Put that rifle
on the ground.
Take it on off your neck.
I will take
it. I'm unarmed.
Take it off your neck.
I have a camera.
Take it off your neck.
What the hell's the matter with you?
Can we all calm down?
Put it down. Barrel down. Set it down. Step back. You're carrying a sidearm as well.
It's all legal, sir.
Sir, drop the fucking gun on your side now.
Put the gun on your side now.
What's the matter with you? It's 100% lawful. Open carry is legal in Michigan. There's no different in this area here. This is a public common area. You fucking stand down. I'm unarmed. You stop pointing your fucking gun at me. What the fuck is the matter with all of you? I came in here to file a complaint against you assholes.
On the ground right now.
I'm not going to touch my sidearm.
Then lay on the ground on your face.
You're walking in the police department loaded, okay?
So what? It's legal.
Put your hand above your head. All the way above your head.
I don't have any cuffs.
I got them. Sir, step back. In the gray, step back.
This is my camera. I'm here to file a complaint.
Well,
I'm not breaking the law. You want to shoot me? You want to shoot me over nothing?
You can file your complaint in a minute. Step back. Step back.
This is
You're disobeying a lawful order.
I'm not breaking any laws.
If you disobey this order, you will be placed under arrest.
You will be arrested.
What the fuck is the matter with you? Do I have a gun, Dickweed? Stop pointing your fucking... Fuck you. I haven't done anything wrong.
Put your hands above your head. Put your hands above your head. Do not move, sir.
I don't want you doing that.
Yep, there's a camera on his back. Got a handgun.
Open this up.
Put your hands above your head.
I'm not doing anything. You don't tell me what to do, dude. I'm your boss. You understand? My tax dollars pay yours. Give me my fucking camera.
What the hell's the matter with you?
Okay. Do not move, sir. That's a good plan.
I thought so too.
Smooth move, pal. Smooth move.
That was beautiful. So I like that buildup. He was running his mouth real reckless all that time, which is amazing to me that somebody would have the unmitigated gall to stand there and just talk crazy in that kind of environment and just be so antagonistic. But he felt like, hey, I got this camera. They're not going to shoot because I got the camera. But again, he's not the one with the rifle. The guys with the rifles were like really much more cooperative because they knew that their ass was on the hot seat to get shot. Since he didn't have a weapon and then shooting him wouldn't have been as easy, he felt free to run his mouth. But had they started shooting those guys, who'd say he wouldn't have got hit? He was real stupid. He's real stupid. Well,
the whole thing was real stupid.
It was from the beginning to end. And all this does is make them look worse because he came in there. First of all, you say you're a journalist. You're not a journalist if you make yourself part of the story.
He. In fact, I thought I heard him say, I'm Don Lemon.
I
thought that's what he said.
Well, he's an even worse journalist than Don Lemon because he got involved in it. And he didn't even spell legal right. Yeah, you're a journalist. You didn't go to journalism school. If you did, just keep English because you spelled legal wrong. So, wow. Yeah, but the dude is talking real crazy to the police and refusing to go along with the program. And that's where they got him because they're giving him orders. They're trying to find out what's going on. These guys are armed. Maybe he's armed too. We don't know. And so now we're going to give you orders to get out of our way while we deal with this. And the dude is, first of all, he didn't want to back out of the way. He's being resistant when they're telling him to move out of the way. Then finally he does move.
Right.
Then he turns back around and I don't know. This is not going to help their case should it ever make it to civil court.
Exactly.
This will not help their case at all because all you did was blatantly antagonize those officers.
Yeah, and old Sarge with the gauge. Check out Sarge with the
gauge.
Oh,
yeah. Oh, yeah.
But what was the
yeah, the chicken
the
wing
elbow
up.
Out there.
Yeah, the chicken wing up there, you know. He needs to take some SGI classes, drop that chicken wing. But no, you know what? But they were ready to drop the hammer on those dudes because they didn't know what was going on.
Yeah. That didn't make any sense. You can't walk into a police station In any state, for God's sake. But walk in looking like the North Hollywood shootout suspects?
Right. That's what I'm telling you. That's ridiculous.
What do you call it? Balaclava?
The balaclava and the body armor. And I mean, because then it's like you came for battle. Why do you have a body armor on? And again, it goes back to the point of you can be doing something that is technically legal. All that means is when it gets sorted out, you might not be convicted of it.
Right.
That doesn't mean you're not going to get slammed on the ground. Doesn't mean you're not going to go to jail. Doesn't mean you're not going to have to stand trial and pay for a lawyer, et cetera, et cetera. It just means that at the end of the day, maybe you won't be convicted of it. That's all it means. So don't do dumb shit. Play stupid games, win stupid prizes.
Like your boy Wyclef.
Right. Now I saw something about that. So I guess it was mistaken identity.
Why did the sheriff's department have to put out a whole?
They put out a whole statement apologizing. Okay, so this is what we always talk about.
Unbelievable.
This is what I always say. Comply now, complain later. And he complained later, but he didn't comply. And here's why I say that. Apparently, there was a robbery, and the vehicle in the robbery matched the vehicle he was riding in.
Now, is Wyclef a rapper?
He's a member of the Fugees. He's a big time producer. Songwriter, and he actually ran for president of Haiti at one point. He's Haitian. So he's a Renaissance man, okay? Now, why he was riding around West Hollywood a 2002 Honda, I don't know. But maybe that was the weed lady's car. I don't know. But it just, as it turns out, there was a robbery committed by a male black who was riding in a similar vehicle driven by a female. He was riding in a vehicle driven by a female, very similar. So, and leaving the area, okay? So, as he was leaving the area, Sheriff's Department sees what appears to be matching description, okay? So, so they ended up pulling him over, and now he gets out of the car. And I guess they're telling him, hey, stay in the car.
He said, now, I'm a producer, for God's sake.
I'm Wyclef John, you know? So, I'm with the Fugees. I'm down with the Fugees, you know? But no, in his mind, this is the point I always try to make to people. He knows that he has done nothing wrong, but he does not know what they are working with. He doesn't know the information that they have.
Right.
He doesn't know what somebody said he did or what those officers have reason to believe he might have done. And this is why you got to always cooperate, because although you know that you didn't do anything, you don't know where the officers are coming from. Somebody might have said. He had no idea that a robbery had just been committed where the guy put the gun to people's head, he pistol whipped some people and took all of their stuff, and then left in a vehicle like that one, driven by a woman.
Right.
He had no idea. All he knows is I'm being pulled over and guns are pointed at me. When I haven't done anything?
As he was leaving the crime scene, I think he said, and I'm a music producer. And he left.
A Grammy-winning music producer. The Fugees actually were a big deal. And I guess he's still pretty much a big deal. He went on social media. He went on, well, Lauryn Hill's a big deal. And then Wyclef John and then Proz would be like the third rank in that group, right? They're kind of like the Black Eyed Peas. So I guess he tweeted out or made a post or something to say, I just got jammed up by the sheriff.
For racial profiling.
And I didn't do anything. Racial profiling. I didn't do anything. Okay. Well, in this case, I think if you look at the statement, I'm glad they actually did put that statement out, because it clearly just lines everything up and it clearly articulates why they did what they did. They're trying to avoid a shitstorm. Because you know how that goes. This guy's got a social media following. He's looking to garner, garner publicity. I was going to say sympathy. Mm-hmm. Publicity, and get his name out there, because that's part of what he does as an entertainer, is he needs to keep his name out there.
And if it gets big enough, you know, he can get Jesse and Al Sharpton.
And Al Sharpton, et cetera,
and,
right?
And that group, and hey, who knows? So, there might be a payout.
So, well, you know, I don't know that he needs that, because he's been pretty successful. But the fact of the matter is he can still get some pub off of it, some publicity off of it, right?
Some pub.
Some pub, right? Some publicity, some shine. How about that?
All right. No shade, no.
No shade, shine. No shade, shine. There's a difference between shade and shine.
All right.
All right. So he can still get some mileage out of it, right? But they shot that down by putting out that 4-page letter or whatever, however long it was, clearly articulating, this is what happened. This is what the people look like. This is what they did. This is where it was. And then homeboy shows up in the same location, same description, leaving the area, and we stopped him.
Looking just like a 211.
Looking just like the person matching the rough description, okay? And so we stopped him, man. And then when he got out the car, this is how he acted. So apparently he's trying to go to the trunk of his car, and he's telling him, go to the trunk of the car. Don't go to the trunk of your car. Why can't I go to truck in my car? Hey, man, we ain't about to have a board meeting about it. Okay? I just told you don't go to truck your damn car. Okay? That's the kind of thing to get you tased.
Oh, my God.
At the very least, that's the kind of thing to get you tased. But this is why I tell people, man, you know you didn't do anything, but you don't know what the cops know or what the cops think they know. And that's all they'll be held on later, to be judged on later, is what they, in good faith, believed to be the case at the time it went down. So don't be an idiot, Wyclef John. Yeah, so anyway, that's what happened there.
Oh, man.
Amazing, right?
It is amazing. I just said, you know, I was a police explorer, you know, in the mid-70s, right before, in the Adam 12 version of the city of Los Angeles. And, you know, in those days, if you got stopped, people didn't jump out of the car and didn't want to argue, like, why are you stopping me?
Well,
waited, for God's sake.
But because the police had unconditional support back then, and you could get a hole put in yourself doing that, and nobody was going to have to answer for it.
They didn't have unconditional support, number one.
Oh, yeah.
And number two, you know, there used to be some level of respect. You know, if you weren't a criminal, you were always an asshole with the cops.
Sometime it was business as usual. Business as usual. I've had some really, really bad people be very calm because they've interacted with the police so many times. And if you pull them over for running a red light or the guy's like, I've been to jail for robbery. This ain't nothing. I know I don't have anything on me. I'm just going to. Usually.
Those are
professional criminals.
Cooperative suspects.
Those are pros.
You be stopping.
Those are professional criminals.
But, back in those days, you know, before you were born.
Before my time.
You was just, you know, I think you was still running around in Pampers somewhere.
Yeah, right. Yeah, they have Pampers back then.
You see what I'm saying? You probably wore cloth diapers, you know.
Yeah.
With big old pins on the side.
The safety pins. Even back then. Even back then I had a safety pin. <right? laughs>
But it was different, you know. And I think police back then when they interacted with parolees or people who had been in state prison or, career criminals, there was a way that they dealt with them. But the general public was different.
They got a different treatment, sure.
And the general public acted differently. The general public didn't act like criminals.
Right.
Today.
And they didn't get treated like criminals typically.
Correct. Today, you know, they want to jump out the car.
Well, can people know their rights? People want to say, hey, you can't do this to me.
But they don't know whether they can or can't.
They think they know their rights.
They think, exactly.
Yeah.
I remember one dude, you can't do this. What law school did you go to?
Right.
And he just looked at me and said, you didn't even finish middle school. What you talking about, Willis? You want to tell me the law?
Yeah.
Please.
Turn
around, put your hands behind your back. I'll tell you the law.
Yeah, we'll figure it out later. You know, you can.
Meanwhile.
You can use the prison law library to Google it. You can check it out there.
Meanwhile, you have the right to remain silent.
Yeah, exactly. Well, that's kind of what happens when people
make me call him names.
Willis. So, look, we're going to go to our second break, and then we're going to come back and jump into our story. We're going to talk about the terror attacks in London, and we're going to call it that. That's what it was.
That's what it was.
All right. See you in a minute.
And the suspect was an Asian. Just tell me. Say whatever I want to whoever I want,
whenever I want, wherever I want, however I want. However I do so. All right. And that was Drug Ballad by Eminem. Marshall Mathers.
I thought it was that white rapper dude. Who's this? Vanilla Fudge or Vanilla something? I don't know.
No, this is a good white rapper.
Oh, okay.
All right. Yeah. So, all right. So we have we had an incident happen and outside the Parliament in London yesterday. And actually, I was watching the news and walking around my house listening to the TV news. You know, you turn the TV up so you can hear it. Wherever you are in the house, and they said they broke in and said there's been a shot fired outside Parliament in the Westminster section of London, and that Parliament was locked down,
right,
as a precaution, and they didn't say anything else. They didn't say they just said, hey, we'll catch up on this. And I'm thinking it. I was thinking my first thought. My American brain says a single shot,
some crackpot.
That ain't nothing. But in London,
some white supremacists.
That's a big deal. Well, apparently they use knives now in Times Square in New York. But there's a But in London, I guess it's a big deal for somebody to crack off a round, you know?
Well, they're not used to gunshots. They don't even, they don't even like guns.
They don't even want the police to be armed.
The police officer who got killed was unarmed.
Yeah. Well, he didn't have a gun. I'm not going to say he was unarmed, but he didn't have a gun.
He didn't have a gun.
Yeah. So apparently that was the suspect, the terror suspect, being killed.
Right.
By the armed police. And then they, you know,
and in London. The second layer.
The second layer, right. And in London, they have the police and then they have the armed police. And the armed police actually get to carry guns and stuff. They don't have to run back and check them out. They can actually, roll around the city being ready. And I guess it's a counterterror thing. And looking at some of the photos, this guy's got some pretty high speed equipment too. So I hope they're well trained on it. So there's a video we have that's going to lay out what happened and then we'll come back and talk about it. No, just to the part where the prime minister comes on. Theresa May.
The first video of the Westminster attack may be from a distance, but from right to left, it clearly shows the speeding car careering up the inside of the traffic. And in the water, a splash as one of the pedestrians fell from the bridge. Here is that car, surrounded by emergency workers. Witnesses described it zigzagging and ploughing into pedestrians. It crashed into the railings of Parliament, having left the road and crossed a segregated cycle lane onto the pedestrian walkway. A Reuters photographer who was on the scene when it happened took a number of pictures portraying the horrific aftermath. One person was thrown down a set of stairs from the bridge onto a walkway beneath. Another person was thrown into the river itself and pulled alive from it with serious injuries. A woman's body could be seen from the air under the back wheels of a London bus. She died at the scene, only a couple of hundred metres from the major hospital many others were taken to.
Now, basically, we were just coming across the bridge and then we just heard a bang and then we just saw three people in the road. And then someone called out if anyone got first aid experience and a couple of us went running to help see what could.
I could hear screams and then we heard gunshots again. And as we looked along the bridge, because we were only crawling along the bridge, there was bodies, literally.
Must have been about 10 bodies.
This video, taken by the former Polish foreign minister, showed the attempts made by members of the public to give first aid to the casualties, even before the emergency services arrived. But the carnage continued. The driver then abandoned the vehicle, ran around the corner to the gate of Parliament, and attacked a police officer with a large knife inside the grounds. The policeman was fatally wounded. The attacker then shot dead by armed police.
It is clear that the advice from the police and the director of security is still that the chamber should remain in lockdown.
Members of Parliament were kept locked inside the chamber of the House of Commons and were only let out more than 2 hours later. Outside, the scene was more chaotic. As the public fled, so the emergency services moved in to put into effect a major incident that they had trained for over and over again. A wide cordon was thrown around the area. All the roads were closed. The government's emergency committee with the acronym COBRA met, chaired by the Prime Minister, with briefings from the intelligence services, who will have to answer now as to whether they could have foreseen such a threat to public safety.
Tomorrow morning, Parliament will meet as normal. We will come together as normal.
So, and since ISIS has claimed responsibility for the attack. And, you know,
they directed him or is he just an ISIS inspired?
I think he's inspired. Okay. But they said, and this is part of the ISIS playbook, that if you're in an environment where you can't get guns, because obviously they'd rather go in and shoot up a bunch of people like we saw in San Bernardino and like we saw down in
Orlando.
They'd rather do that. It's a lot more, a lot higher body count. But if you can't do that, if you're in an environment like England where you can't necessarily readily lay your hands on guns, they encouraged them to use vehicles, knives. We saw this in Nice, France, with the guy who stole the truck and run a bunch of people over, right? So, you know, unfortunately, you can try to restrict guns, and you can't. And that's an environment where they've done a really good job of restricting access to guns. They've been very successful at it. And they don't have the same level of gun-related deaths we do, but people get stabbed to death all the time in England. And we see that a dedicated, motivated attacker is going to find some way to bring a lot of carnage to a situation. And that's, you know, anybody can get a truck or a bus or a van and just plow down. Now, you know, I'll give you an example. I went up, I took my my two youngest children who are in there right now, We went up to the Palm Springs aerial tramway.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So we did that on Monday and went up there and had dinner. And when I got up there, I realized, you know, this is a very isolated location. You have to take the tram up. There's no other way to get up there besides a helicopter. Okay. You can take a helicopter, you can take the tram. You ain't hiking up there. I don't care who you are. You ain't hiking up there. That's like miles up in the air. It's so high up, there was still snow on the ground, and it hadn't snowed for 2 weeks.
Right.
It's 40 degrees cooler up there. That's how high it's up. So I was thinking, you know, because they're not searching anybody going up there. So I'm thinking, you know, if they wanted to come up here and just, like, lock this place down and make it like a stronghold, like a barricade, man, you'd have to send guys up with helicopters.
Call for a gunship.
And by the time you got that helicopter up there, what could they have done? You know, how many people could they have damaged there? Could they have hurt up there? So I was thinking, you know, there's a lot of targets in our environment still, even in this security conscious times that we have now. But it so happened that nobody's gone up there and done anything.
Yeah.
If you wanted to get high enough to disperse something in the air, that's pretty high up there, man. It's pretty high up there. It's beautiful too once you get up. If you've never been, you're in Southern California, I suggest you go. But it just made me start thinking because of how my mind works that this is a vulnerability.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So even if you and so you don't have to have a gun, a bomb, a whatever. If you're thinking and you're motivated, and especially if you've gotten some education online or elsewhere from somebody who deals in death, man, you can still do a whole lot. And mm-hmm. we just saw that happen there.
Yeah. It also speaks to medical emergencies.
Definitely. You saw them working on those people out there?
Yeah.
That's a mass casualty incident.
That's right. And when, you know, just like I was talking about my dog earlier, you know, you have to be prepared. When you're at home in your car or at work or wherever, you have to be prepared for everything that can happen.
Yeah.
So, you know, I mean, here we are doing our show, our little show, right? I can protect myself. I can take care of you.
Right.
I can do first aid. I've got a tourniquet.
Got to be ready.
It's all just there.
Yeah.
And it's just always in my car, in the house, on my body if I'm working. And so, I don't think people, especially in America, I'm not sure about it because they said people asked anybody to have any first aid experience, and that guy and some other people ran over to see what they
right.
could do. So I hope they ran over just to, you know, because they did know something, not just, well, I don't have any experience, but
I want to see. Let me get my phone out and see what I can.
I didn't see anybody with phones. I think if it had been America, we'd have seen people
definitely.
At their phones. But. You know, we always think, well, it can never happen to us. You know, it's not going to happen to me.
But
I'm on vacation.
But the culture's got a shit. That, I'm on vacation. You know, an American was killed over there.
Yeah.
American was killed. I think he's from Kansas City.
Yeah, they were celebrating their 25th wedding anniversary.
God, did he get killed over there?
Yeah.
In jolly old England. You just never know.
But, you know, that's why, you know, when I was teaching, my mantra in the classroom was, every day is training day. That means that every day you have to do something, whether it's fight, shoot, knife, medical, read something to make you better at what you – every day is training day. If you're not training every day for
something
in your field, you're silly. You might as well go do something else. Might as well go flip
burgers, yeah, because you ain't real.
At Bargar King or something.
Well, you know, we just trained a group of 29 people from a local corporate entity, and that's all I'll say. But they're not security people. They're civilians who work in an office building,
mm-hmm.
okay? And we put 29 of them through a basic trauma care class where they receive first aid, CPR, AED, and here's the new hotness, and this is the big one, bleeding control for the injured,
right.
BCON. So first aid, AED, CPR, and BCON training. And basically, that's tourniquet application,
mm-hmm.
tourniquet management, wound management. Basically, how to apply blood stoppers, how to stop somebody from bleeding out. Because that's why most people die. Let's
that's
be
right.
clear: you get shot or you get stabbed. Usually, you're going to die because you bled out from being shot or stabbed. It's not
right.
necessarily that injury is what would have killed you you not lost as much blood.
In my classroom, we had a big sign on the wall and that said, "People don't die from getting shot." People die from major organ damage and blood loss.
Right, and blood loss is huge, right? So
you got 3 minutes.
And if you look up, there's a new hashtag they're putting out as part of this. It's called hashtag stop the bleed. And that hashtag will lead you to all these resources the Department of Homeland Security is putting out because the idea is to get the public trained.
Right.
And you have to be trained because you just never know when something's going to happen. Again, mass casualty incident. Now, a mass casualty incident technically is 4 or more people injured in the same incident. With severe injuries in the same incident. This is clearly more than that. First of all, we had five people who died eventually.
Right.
And there was like 40 people who were injured.
Yeah, it was like 40.
When him running people over with a car. Okay, so a mass casualty incident means that your EMS is going to be overwhelmed. Your emergency medical system is overwhelmed. They don't have enough ambulances to transport 40 people.
Right.
They don't have enough room at the hospital to deal with 40 critically injured people coming in the ER all at once.
And when the
incident, you got to be able to provide some level of pre-hospital care.
When the incident occurs, it's going to be 3 or 4 minutes before they even get to you. So
yeah.
If whoever I'm with, if you bleed out in 3 minutes, whoever I'm with, if they can't stop the bleeding, I'm done. If I go into cardiac arrest, if you don't start doing chest compressions at least without breathing, just the chest compressions until somebody gets to me or until I start, you start getting a pulse again. If you don't do that, I'm history.
You know what they've got now?
If you kneel at my side and say, "Oh my God, are you okay?
Right, to wipe away the sweat.
I'm not answering. No,
I can't. I can't answer. If I can answer,
I'd
be okay.
I'm dying."
But now they have these things that you wrap around your chest like a belt, and it does the compressions for you.
Really?
It's actually pretty cool. Yeah, I just saw that. Somebody posted it from some medical conference, and you attach it around the person's chest, and you press the button, and it's all automated.
Wow.
And it does the compressions, which is good because that's going to save lives because that thing doesn't get tired.
Right.
It knows the exact number to do, et cetera. And all you have to do is use the airway to breathe for them.
It's like the AED. That's why they're more and
it's all automated.
In public places. And yep. A simpleton can work the damn thing.
Well, that's the idea. Well, and this is what amazed me. Okay. So the idea of an automated external defibrillator, an AED, is that if your heart stops beating, then somebody can snatch a thing off a wall, follow the instructions, and put the leads on you in the right place, push the button when they say, step back, and you're going to get a jolt, and it's going to test to see if it worked or not, and then it'll shock you again. So they're meant to be used by strangers under duress who've never seen one before. Why does everybody have to go through so much training to know how to use them as a first responder? You wouldn't think it would be that big a deal. Mm-hmm. But I guess the idea is our incidence of occurrence is going to be much higher.
Right.
As a first responder, right. And I'm glad that people do. Come on out and take the training. But the idea is that they're very easy to
you
use.
Guys have some really good stuff going on out there.
I mean, you should come out there now with those shooting simulators in. Man, it's like it's a tactical Disneyland now.
Yeah.
So come on out. Do some pull-ups and do some shooting and learn how to do chest compressions. So, so an incident like this just kind of drives it home. And ISIS isn't going to stop. And they're saying the reason that ISIS is now coming more to do this sort of thing is because they're getting their ass handed to them on the battlefield.
Yeah.
And now they have to shift. And that's why they're telling their followers, hey, get out there and put in some work. Because they know they can't go conventional head up. They've never been able to do that. Al-Qaeda was never able to go heads up against a conventional military force.
Now, ISIS did against the Iraqi army.
Well, that's the Iraqi army, yeah. Yeah, that's true. But against the American army, they know they didn't stand a chance. I mean, we just had just too well trained and too well equipped and too highly motivated for them to
call
bring
for
it.
A gunship
so
got to do it that way. Minute.
Yeah, so they got to do it that way. So anyway, that's going to come back here, and it's already been here. Let's be clear.
That's right.
ISIS hit San Bernardino. ISIS hit Orlando.
It's already happened,
and it's going to happen again.
Yep.
So, and I always tell people, we've been saying this forever. It's not if it's going to happen. It's when it's going to happen.
And here's the question. When it does happen, how prepared will you be?
Right. Are you ready to deal with that? Because, he didn't say if, when it does happen. So get yourself somewhere to save your own life or save someone else's life or defend yourself, et cetera.
Right. In dealing with Evie, my pet, the stress that was on me, little things started to go wrong.
Sure.
So being able to push past that frustration, being able to think clearly, go, okay, I got to do this, I got to do that, and continue to move and not stopping, trying to, because if it's somebody you love, if it's your wife, your kid, your husband.
The stakes are a lot higher.
They're high.
Yeah, they are.
And that's not the time to panic. That's not the time to give up. That's not the time to say, oh my God, what do I do?
Right.
Somebody call me.
Come up with a plan. Yeah, you should already have a plan.
Mental gymnastics.
We have a caller. What's your name and where you calling from?
Unfortunately, it's me again.
We got a one call rule, brother.
Hey, look, man, I'm making
Willie Sweet, Wonka Joe. What you got?
Hey, look. All right, look. First of all,
look.
I'm,
Look,
I feel sorry. I feel sorry for innocent people who lose their lives, right?
Do you?
But yeah, I do.
All right, okay, all right.
He ain't going to pay $1,200 to save him, but he feels sorry for him.
Yeah, that little dog, that little dog story earlier, I don't know.
I ain't paying $1,200 for no damn dog.
I'm concerned about you.
Listen, man, but unfortunately, the world is what it is. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I come from an environment. I grew up in an environment where death is around the corner every day. You know what I'm saying? So I feel sorry for the innocent people who lost their lives, but you reap what you sow. Your rich people, your corporations, your government, they kill millions of people, and you know that's what happens. You know what I mean? That's
how the world operates. And that's the whole argument of one man's terrorist is another man's freedom fighter, right? Et cetera, et cetera. And I'm all for that if you're a freedom fighter fighting against an invading force in your own land. When you start going out and killing people who got nothing to do with that, you're just a terrorist, man. There's no freedom you're fighting for. You're just killing people.
Warfare has always evolved, George.
Well, right, and it's asymmetrical now. We understand that. We both have studied that extensively.
Now, today, what we have today is proxy wars. So, for example, America and certain countries in Europe, they finance African military.
Sure, and let them go fight for it. Sure, sure.
Or you know what I'm saying? To go into places like the Congo or Angola or Mali and kill Africans who want to nationalize the resources. America, England, they like, nah, fuck that. We're going to keep in these brutal dictators.
Wow, that's what they said?
You know what I'm saying?
They said like that. Well, you know what? And it's funny you would say that. And this is a topic for a whole other story. We only got 5 minutes left, but I will say this. If you look, you will see that some of those quote-unquote brutal dictators actually did get their training from the United States, either here in the United States or elsewhere. But
right.
But that doesn't mean that it's cool. It doesn't mean that it's right.
It's not cool. And there is no heroes in warfare. It's only people who believe in what they believe in. There is no
right, because nobody thinks they're wrong. Even ISIS is not there saying, you know, we shouldn't even be doing this, but we're assholes, so let's go do it. They believe in what they're doing, but we still got to say that wrong is wrong.
You got Muslims who are crazy. You got white people who are Christians who are crazy and want to kill Muslims. So there is no good guys to this shit, man. You know what I'm saying? But, George, I want to get on the phone. I want to ask you this question, though, because I forgot earlier, right? George, you heard about those handcuffs nowadays with the taser installed in them and all that stuff?
Oh, that's been around. Yes, that's a custody thing.
Okay, okay.
Yeah, they do that for custody.
All right, look. Well, one day I was driving down the street over here in Atlanta, and I seen the police. They was off to the side of the road practicing with this big-ass drone. And you know how I feel about the police, George. You know what I'm saying?
Well,
I know the police.
Hey, you must be a snitch because you done called the police twice tonight already.
No. Don't put that on the street, man. Don't put that on the street. You know what I mean? Willie Sweet don't snitch on nobody. You know what I mean? But for real, George, you know how I feel about the police. I know y'all fight crime and y'all catch child molesters and all that. But I also understand that your duty is to protect the 1% from the people who are getting raped out here. But when it comes to things like
they're raping everybody out here. Hide your kids, hide your wife.
Right.
Okay.
When it comes to things like drones, George, you know, I understand how human nature is. If you give a man a shovel, he'll use it to dig a hole in the ground and plant flowers. You give another man a shovel, he'll use it to beat his wife in the head and dig a ditch and dump her body in it.
Wow.
So my question
is
to
tool.
You, George.
Just a tool, like a gun. Just a tool.
Right. If the police are using drones now, the police, what are they using it for, George? And I'll get off the phone and I'll just hear your answer.
We'll give
you
answer off the air. Okay.
All right.
Very cool. Thanks for the call, Willie Sweet Wonka Joe. Basically, drones can be used for the same thing the police helicopters are used for. Observation. Aerial observation is the deal. Now, when we talk about aerial observation, we don't just mean observing what's going on at the exact moment. Before the police serve a search warrant, we will go out, and we used to be able to go up in the helicopter with the crew and take your own photos. Mm-hmm. But they realized that it would be better if they had regularly scheduled flights that would take off just to go out and take pictures with a professional photographer from SID, from Scientific Investigation mm-hmm. Division, would go up. You tell them what you want a photo of, and they'll go up and get the photos, and they'll bring them back and give them to you. So that way, you kind of get an idea of the lay of the land of the places you're getting ready to serve the search warrant on. And there's a whole bunch of other stuff I won't get into is why they do that, but there's a very practical reason that's done. So you could do the same thing with a drone. Mm-hmm. The only thing is that I don't really know. It's not quite the same as a guy saying, oh, I want to take a picture of that. Let me take a picture of this, this, and this. A guy can pick out things on the ground that are of interest maybe and zoom in better than a drone can do. Mm-hmm. But that's why. And drones are a hell of a lot cheaper than helicopters. Right. And if drones crash, the flight crew doesn't die.
Right. They're pretty sophisticated now in terms of the camera capabilities. You know, they can do infrared. They can do
flare. Oh, sure.
They can also zoom in and, you know, tighten up. And, you know, some of the newer, cooler ones, you know, you can set them up there and mark your target, and it just follows it.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Nice.
It just follows your target, you know, wherever it's going. So, you know, if you can follow your dog running.
Really? Know, that's
you,
cool.
You can follow a suspect. If you can catch him and mark him, wherever he goes, the drone's just going to
follow him. And the drone's just on him. Yeah. And then the drone, guess what? The drone doesn't ask for overtime. The drone doesn't need to use the bathroom. The drone doesn't need to stop and get coffee.
The drone can't call his union rep.
Right. So the drone, that's pretty cool. You can put a drone on somebody and tag them. Because what we've had to do in the past is use tracking devices to follow somebody where they're going.
Right.
If you can do it with the drone, it's even better.
Yeah. And there's also been, I think for security operations, you know, I know when I do my thing, you know, I plan to get one. And so, you know, when we have, an location like, say, a studio, right?
Right, like a studio.
That's a great location because it's not going anywhere.
Right.
I know it. I know where my people are. But if I have, you know, 5,000 people at an event, I can also put my thing up in the air, my drone up there, and I can kind of monitor from overhead.
Sure.
And it just gives me another perspective. But I know in the city, you know, they're pretty
all
particular.
All kind of rules and guidelines and regulations.
About where you can actually deploy that thing. But, you know, you can't do anything in California. Unless you're a criminal, this is a great place to be. But if you're a police officer, you know, you're just, you know.
You're constrained.
By political correctness, you know, the city of L.A., you know, it's a sanctuary state, it's a sanctuary city. We're not going to, you know, L.A. City. And here's what I really wanted to talk to Marshall about. And at some point, I would like to get him on. The mayor says that now LAPD Special Order 40, now
right.
the Port Police
and the airport
and
police.
The LAX Police have to abide by those same rules with regard to
right. Now, he responded to your
detainer.
Comment on social media.
He did.
But it would be better. Yeah, we'll get him on. We'll
but it was just a little like, come on, Gil.
Right, come on, Gil. Cut it out. It's not like they were. And that's true. And Special Order 40 basically is if you arrest somebody, we're not going to ask them their immigration status. We're not going to do the whole ICE check and all that. But even when we did back in the day, and this was Marshall's point, they weren't coming out. Now they will, though. Now they would come out.
Now they will.
But 10 years ago, man, you would sit there trying to put immigration hold on somebody. They weren't going to do that.
But all you do is take an MDC, for God's sakes.
Yeah, you could do that.
Drive them over there, drive under the thing, drop them off. See ya. Let me tell you something. After September 11th, we, you know, doing the talking about bounty hunter stuff, there are some bondsmen that only do immigration bonds.
Oh, really?
And so after September 11th, all of a sudden people wanted to know where these people were. We were just driving all over the places going,
yeah.
Hey, how you doing?
What's up?
Felipe? Yeah. Hi, step out here, please. Oh, no, posibles, no, posibles. Stack of wrong way. I know. Turn around, put your hands on your head.
Wow.
And then drive right down to MDC, drive down the thing. Leave your guns in the car, take them in.
But see, that's the thing is you can do that because all you've got on them is an immigration charge, right?
They was happy.
But if I arrested somebody for robbery, which is a local charge, I can't take them to the Metropolitan Detention Center.
Well, he should be in jail, for God's sake.
Well, that's what they're saying. So you can't really go and drop them off there. You have to make a call and put an ICE hold on them, and then they can deal with him
and
later.
It doesn't take any more time.
But they ain't coming, though.
It doesn't take any more
time. Well, again, they might come now.
They're coming now, but...
No, they might come now, yeah.
It doesn't take any more time than putting a parole hold on somebody or a probation hold on somebody.
That wasn't quick and easy either, now that you mention it. But, yeah, you're right. And now the political will is there.
They ain't going nowhere.
Now the political will is there to do it. So we are at our show's end. It's been an hour and a half already. Can you believe that?
Is it really?
90 minutes. 90 minutes, man. Wow. 90 minutos. So, listen... we are going to return, and I will actually not be here next week, but I will be backfilled by J.B. Williams, who will be holding it down with you. So
who's that?
He came here before. You know who he is.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that guy.
JB.
And JB's actually got a pretty good guess he's trying to line up. So that would be really good. We'll hold off on a tidbit till we get it confirmed, but it's pretty exciting.
All right. This is some progressive, no doubt.
No.
Oh, okay.
Actually, you'll like it.
Well, praise the Lord.
Yeah, you'll like him. And you'll be thrilled, and he'll be the third person in that position that you've interviewed. So anyway, we'll be back next week. In the meantime, you can follow us on Instagram, A Ride Along Radio Show. You can like us on Facebook, and you can follow us on Twitter at Ride Along Radio. And until then, I'm George Holt.
I'm Gil Contreras.
And we'll see you guys later. Don't forget to leave those comments down here on the YouTube, all that smart mouth stuff you like to say. Leave it down there.
And good night, Evie, wherever you are.
Yep.